Well, I'm delighted to be with you tonight in Maybank, Texas. And I'm always very grateful for this privilege to come and speak to you and be a part of your worship. I've been with you several times before, and it's always a delight for me, first of all, to receive the invitation to come and then to actually be with you and to listen to some of the lectures and to be involved in the lectureship myself. So to the elders of this fine congregation, let me say thank you for your kind invitation. I'm very grateful for you who are with us tonight. I'm very grateful for this fine lectureship, the theme, and the subject which has been given to me this evening. I bring you greetings from the Broadway Church of Christ in Tyler, Texas, and encourage you to come and be with us whenever you possibly can. We always love to have visitors, and your visit is always a welcome opportunity for us. We look forward to it whenever you can possibly be with us. Tonight, I've been given the subject, one of the more fundamental subjects of all the Bible, and that is the standard of the second coming and the judgment of Jesus Christ. And there are a lot of fundamental aspects of the Bible that we need to know. There's a lot of fundamental doctrines that we must come to an understanding upon. We must come to an understanding about man and man's need, created by the power and the Word of God, guilty of sin. All have committed sin, come short of the glory of God. We all come to an understanding. Man needs that Savior that God sent into the world. There are certain fundamental doctrines. We are guilty of sin, and we need the salvation that God has to offer through Jesus Christ and our obedient faith. We need to understand about the salvation that God has offered us through the Bible and all that's involved in that salvation. The need to repent of sin and confess our faith, be baptized into Christ for the remission of sins, the Lord adding us to His church, Acts chapter 2, and our continued living of the Christian life, Romans chapter 12, 1 and 2. We all understand some of these important doctrinal matters. The death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, what a fundamental matter that really is. But of all these matters, I'd have to include in this as well the great day of judgment that we are going to face one day. It is not a happenstance. It is not a if we are going to face God in judgment. It is a fact that we are. And what will be the standard of that judgment? That'll be the focus of my attention and time tonight. In order to establish a better understanding of the focus, let me spend some time in establishing a foundation. I want to talk first of all about the fact of the second coming of Christ. I want to talk about the fact that there is going to be a judgment. With that foundation laid before us, then we can appreciate more what the standard of the judgment will be. And then as a fourth element tonight, I want to talk about practical matters of application, because I don't want to just stand up here and discuss these biblical matters without applying them to myself personally. And I want to think about now, what is that going to do for me? Is that going to make me a better Christian? Is that going to change my ways from darkness to light? How's that going to affect me personally? And then surely every one of us can go away from this building tonight determined to live the Christian life more so than when we came. And if we're not children of God tonight, surely with an understanding of the fact that God's coming again and is going to hold us accountable for what we do in this life, you'll want to become a child of God and obey the gospel plan of salvation. That's my desire for you tonight, if need be. So without any further introductory discussion, let us delve into these four important elements and discussion matters so that we can understand it as best we can in the time that has been allotted. First of all, I want to talk about the fact of the second coming of Jesus Christ. There's a lot of loose talk about this particular matter, but what does the Bible say? You can go to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and no matter where you go in those particular passages of Scripture, you're going to be reading about the second coming of Christ. Notice, for example, one of my favorite passages of Scripture would have to be John chapter 14. I'm sure you're very familiar with it. I've heard it many times and in many different contexts. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. Jesus, in effect, is saying, I'm going to go to the cross, and take this blood that will be shed and set it before the mercy seat of God, and one day I will come again for you. Turn to the one book of history in the New Testament. It is the book of Acts. And as you turn to that particular passage, you see the ascension of Christ. And involved in that ascension of Christ, there is the fact of the angels that actually talked to the disciples on that occasion and gives us this indication of the matter of the return of Jesus Christ. And when he had spoken these things, verse 9, while they beheld him, he was taken up in a cloud, received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, ye men of Galilee, verse 11, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus which is taken up from you into heaven shall so come in like manner as you have seen him go into heaven. The second coming of Christ is going to be a fact. In addition to the one book of history in the New Testament, you have 21 letters. And those 21 letters are teaching us the importance of living the Christian life. These Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John passages are passages emphasizing growing in faith in who Jesus was and is. The book of Acts tells us how to properly respond to that. And now these 21 letters tell us how to live that in our everyday life. It's a most important discussion and consideration for us as children of God. There are two books of those 21 letters that talk about the second coming of Christ on every page, in every chapter, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians. And you've heard in your reading tonight a portion of 1st Thessalonians chapter 4. In that particular passage of Scripture, he talks about the fact that Christ is coming again. And because of that, we are a people who have hope. He says in verse 13, but I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even others which have no hope. Now I'll pause right there for a moment. And it grieves me at my heart, and I can't tell you how much it does, that there are people out there living in this world tonight who have no hope. They have no hope, but we, as children of God, are people of hope because of our obedience to the gospel and our living that message every day and the hope of the coming of Jesus Christ and the judgment attached to that. Verse 16, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout and with the voice of the archangel and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. There is the fact of the second coming. Now, verse 17, then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Not only are we a people of hope, not only are we a people who are waiting for the second coming of Christ, but we are people who are going to have a new place in which to live in full fellowship with God. There is one book of prophecy in the New Testament. It is the revelation of Jesus Christ recorded by John on the island of Patmos. In the very early moments of this revelation, we have the affirmation of the second coming of Christ. He says in Revelation 1 and verse 7, behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. And so there it is before us. It does not matter where you are in the pages of the New Testament. You're going to come upon the fact of the second coming of Jesus Christ. Whether you're studying the Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John discourse on the life of Jesus Christ, it's going to be there. Or you're studying that book of history, the book of Acts. It begins with the second coming and the teaching of that fact. It's going to happen some great day. Or within those 21 letters that emphasize so much to us about living the Christian life, it's telling us Christ is coming again, and thus we're a people who live with hope. Or that book of Revelation, the one book of prophecy at the end of the Bible, the end of the New Testament, in the very beginning moments of that book, is describing for us the fact that Christ will come again. For us to understand as much as we possibly can about the standard of the judgment, we've got to understand the fact that Christ is coming again. And these Bible writers are not saying, if Jesus comes again, nor are they saying, maybe Jesus will come again, nor do they say, it's possible that Jesus comes again, but they say, when he comes again, and these great items will ensue. One of the great things that will ensue, not only at the second coming of Christ, will be the judgment. The Bible tells us in this regard that all men everywhere are going to have to give an account for the things which they have done in this life. The Bible has a wonderful unity about it, a wonderful ability which only divine inspiration could have given and produced, whereby it talks about these wonderful elements of man, sin, salvation, the origin of man, the destiny of man, in such a unified, marvelous way. The Bible is doing that. It is telling us that God created man from the dust of the ground and breathed into man's nostrils the breath of life. Man became a living soul. The Lord God planted a garden eastward into Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed. What a wonderful picture of man, created by the power of God. What a wonderful discussion about the creation of the material world and man himself. Genesis chapter 1, Genesis chapter 2, verse 7 and 8, which I just read for you this afternoon. But then it also tells us about the problem which man faces, the problem of sin, that all have sinned and have come short of the glory of God. And we know the terrible story involved in that, how that God put man in that garden and gave him dominion over all of the garden. And he said, you may eat of all the trees of the garden, but the tree which is in the midst of the garden, thou shalt not eat, for in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. And you and I know what happened, how that Eve was tempted, and she took of that forbidden fruit and gave to her husband, and he ate. And sin, by means of temptation of the devil and the free moral will of mankind, entered into that perfect world which God had created. But God did not just leave us there. He began to tell us about the responsibility that I have and what he was going to do so that I could be in fellowship with him. Genesis chapter 3 and 15 begins a veiled prophecy of God through the ages working out his divine scheme of redemption, whereby sinful man and righteous God could be brought back together once again. And through the pages of the Bible, we have this wonderful plan. Here is what God has done for us, because God's going to hold us accountable. He's going to hold us responsible for the kind of life that we live, and he's going to hold us responsible for the kind of lives that we should have lived, but we failed to do so. Turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I love to talk about this chapter because it does talk about the judgment. And it talks about this matter of life after this one. For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Beautiful way he describes it there, isn't it? He talks about the fact that this tabernacle of God, this temporary dwelling place which we have, is going to be dissolved. It's like taking a tent down and packing it up and carrying it away. That's like our physical bodies. They're here for a while. For this we groan earnestly, desiring to be clothed upon with our house which is from heaven. And then he talks about this matter of walking by the will of God, describing it as walking by faith and not by sight. And then he comes to the point at hand for the present. Verse 9. Wherefore we labor, that whether present or absent, we may be accepted of him, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he had done, whether it be good or bad. Knowing, therefore, the terror of the Lord, we persuade men, but we are made manifest unto God, that I trust also are made manifest in your consciences. There's going to be a great day of judgment where everyone will have to give an account for what he has done in this life. Notice what he says here in verse 10, and I suppose I'll spend just a few moments with it as I have the opportunity here. Notice the word we. Paul includes himself in that, for we Now, everyone is going to have to face God in the great day of judgment. It is a matter of obligation, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. To say it as the judgment seat of Christ is to say it as stand before the authority, which is Jesus Christ. We must all appear. A friend of mine many years ago made reference to something I guess I knew, but I hadn't quite thought about very much. And he made the point, all cemeteries are on level ground. You don't see cemeteries on a hillside. Cemeteries are always on level ground because all men everywhere die. And that's his point. No matter how high and mighty an individual may be, or how low and humble the individual may become, it does not matter. We all pass from this earthly walk of life. It is appointed unto man once to die, and after that cometh the judgment. And so we have established now this evening two important points as foundational types of matters. We've established the fact that Christ is coming again, though no one knows when it will be. We've established the fact that when Christ does come again, there's going to be a great judgment, and that all men everywhere are going to have to face Christ and his authority in that particular day and that particular time. Almost in eulogy type fashion, the Apostle Paul, in a beautiful book of the Bible, Philippians chapter 2, talks about Jesus Christ, and it's such a beautiful expression about him. Let me read just a phrase or two from that second chapter, beginning in about verse 5. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, was made in the likeness of men. Being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. One great day, men will be making that confession, and they'll be bowing that knee, but for many, it will be too late, because they did not make that good confession nor render obedience to Jesus Christ in this walk of life. Brethren, there's going to be a great judgment. Let's talk a little bit about the standard of that judgment tonight. In the book of Revelation, Revelation chapter 20, you have a very interesting passage of Scripture. And it talks in very picturesque, vivid, symbolic terms about the final judgment. Involved in that is indication of the standard of the judgment. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books, according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged, every man according to their works. You know, did I use a bad word there? According to new modern day Protestantism, works is a bad word. Excuse me if you're insulted or offended that the Bible uses the word works there, or deeds. In other words, God's going to judge you by what you do in this life or what you fail to do in this life. Notice how he uses the word works there for deeds or how we live. They were judged, every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Now, I'd have to agree with the introduction tonight. The most important thing is whether we preach and teach the gospel of Christ or not. That's the most important thing. The most important book or registry that you want to be in is in this book of life. Amen. God has a divine bookkeeping system of sorts, whereby the books were opened, he said, on the day of judgment. The books, one was the Lamb's book of life, and another was the Word of God, whereby all men will be judged according to their works, what they have done, based on the Word of God, the books. Now, at the Broadway Church of Christ, we have a role there, and we have a directory. And we always work hard at keeping the directory up to date. You probably have something similar here. And sometimes we have to add one to the directory, or we have to take one out because of past, or they move to a different location. And we're always working on the directory to make sure the directory is accurate. And I hope it is, but it may not be. There may be some people there on that directory, in that directory it shouldn't be. And maybe there are some that ought to be that are not. I don't know. I hope not. But maybe that's the way it is. But it's not that way with God's record-keeping system. Everyone that's supposed to be in that Lamb's Book of Life is going to be there. And all those who are not there for a reason. He will open up the Lamb's Book of Life, and he will look at our lives, and he will judge them based on the law that we have. Let's study a little bit about the law of God. Turn with me to the book of Romans, Romans chapter 2, and I'll spend just a brief moment talking about that, and I have to be brief. In the second chapter of the book of Romans, the Apostle Paul talks about the fact that the Jews are guilty of sin and are in need of salvation. They've broken the law. He's just finished a rather lengthy discussion in chapter 1 that the Gentiles are guilty of sin, and they in turn need the grace of God and the salvation that Jesus Christ has to offer. Notice how he puts it at the end of chapter 1. I'm in Romans chapter 1. I'm looking at verse 32. Who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death. He means spiritual death there. They're guilty of sins which he has enumerated for us in chapter 1. And those who are guilty of such crimes, such sins, are guilty of spiritual death. Therefore, chapter 2, verse 1, thou art inexcusable, O man, whosoever thou art that judgest. As the Jews were condemning or judging the Gentiles for the sins that they were committed, Paul makes the point, you are guilty as well. You're pointing one finger at them, but you've got three fingers pointed back at you. And you're going to be judged by a higher standard because you had been given the old law, custodian, so to speak, of the revealed will of God. And yet, did you keep it? And the answer to that was no. But we are sure that the judgment of God is according to truth. God's going to judge us according to the truth. God's not going to have a shallow, insignificant, whimsical type of judgment. It's going to be a judgment that's based on his divine will and his divine law, and it's not going to be a superficial kind of judgment. They're going to be judged, and you're going to be judged by the divine will of God. And thinkest thou this, verse 3, O man, that judgest them which do such things, and doest the same, that thou shalt escape the judgment of God? No one's going to be able to hide from that. No one's going to be able to cut a deal with God. No one's going to be able to try to work a deal or do an end run about God and the judgment and the things which have been done or have failed to be done. Or despisest thou the riches of his goodness, verse 4, and forbearance and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. In other words, you've spurned the patience of God. And you cast it away. God was being patient with you. God was leading you to repentance, but you didn't listen and you took advantage of it. And you wouldn't heed the responsibility that you had in repenting of God. God was leading thee to repentance, but you turned away from it. But after thy hardness and impenitent heart, treasurest up unto thyself wrath against the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God. And his point is, you're building sin upon top of sin and kind of piling it on top of each other because of your hardened, rebellious heart. The wrath of God is going to come down upon you, and you're building sin on top of sin. The wrath of God and the judgment of God is a righteous judgment against the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God, Romans chapter 2 and verse 5. And so he's telling us about how serious the matter is. both for the Jew and for the Gentile, who will render to every man according to his deeds. Verse 6, there's that bad word again. God's going to render to every man what he has done. He's going to hold us accountable for the life that we have lived, or the life that we failed to live or should have lived. To them who by patient continuance in well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, eternal life, but unto them that are contentious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, indignation, and wrath. So the standard now is obedience to the truth. It's going to be the standard that you lived under at the time. And he delves into this particular matter. The Jews, having the law of Moses as their standard, did they keep it properly, living under that standard at the time? The Gentile, having a patriarchal type of law, did he live under his standard properly at the time? No, he did not. All have sinned and have come short of the glory of God. The Gentile was guilty of sin. Sin is a transgression of the law. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 4. He had some kind of patriarchal type of law that he in turn had violated and failed to live by, and God's going to hold him accountable. For the individual today, that's you and me, he's telling us, in the day when God shall judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ, verse 16, according to my gospel, that's our standard. The Gentile lived at one time under a patriarchal type of dispensation. God's going to hold him accountable for the law that God gave him. The Jew lived under a Mosaical type of dispensation. God's going to hold him accountable for the law which he gave him at the time. The individual today, both Jew and Gentile now because of the cross, live under the law of Jesus Christ. And God's going to hold us accountable whether we obey that law or not. Every deed, every work, we will be held accountable for it based on the law of Jesus Christ. That's our standard. I'm going to be judged by the standard of Jesus Christ. Now, in my mind, I'm trying to picture what this is all about. There's a great day of judgment. Christ is going to come. I do not know when, nor does anyone. And when Christ comes again, there's going to be a judgment, and the standard of that judgment is going to be the law that I live under at the time before God. For all men everywhere today, it is the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I'm going to be held accountable as to whether I live by it or not. The books will be opened. And from that book, my name, if it's entered into the Lamb's Book of Life, which it is, there in turn is going to be held up next to the inspired gospel of Jesus Christ, the Word of God. You remember what happened a long time ago. There was a faithful child of God in Babylonian captivity. And an old wicked king was having a feast. And as they were filled with revelry and involved in all kinds of debauchery, a hand came from the sleeve of night and wrote on the wall, "Many, many tekel upharsin." When old Belshazzar read that, it filled his heart with fear. And he brought in all the soothsayers and the astrologers. And they were told, if you can interpret what's written on the wall, well, I'm going to give you a purple robe and a gold chain to put around your neck, and you're going to be third in the kingdom of the Babylonians. And all of the soothsayers and all the astrologers looked at that, and in quandary, they could not interpret the handwriting of God on the wall. And the old queen said, you know, I remember a guy back when your father was king, Nebuchadnezzar. He had the insight into these things. Bring him in. His name's Daniel. The king had Daniel brought in. He said, Daniel, his name was changed to Belshazzar. Daniel, we've got a handwriting on the wall there. I'm going to give you a purple robe and a gold chain to put around your neck. I'm going to make you third in the kingdom of the Babylonians, the great world empire. If you can interpret that for us and give us an interpretation of it. Daniel said, basically, you can keep your robe, you can keep your gold chain, and you can keep your title. Because this is the meaning of that writing on the wall. Many, which being interpreted simply means God has numbered this kingdom. Its days are numbered. Tikal, you've been weighed in the balances and found wanting. Upharsin, that Aramaic phrase, thy kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. It was a day of judgment. God has weighed you, and you've been found wanting. That very night, he lost his life. That is the old wicked king. And now the kingdom is being taken by another great world empire, the Medes and the Persians, all according to the divine will of God and Old Testament prophecy. The point is, there's a great day coming, and we're going to have to be prepared for it. And those books will be opened. And my life will be weighed, just like Belshazzar's life was weighed. What will the verdict be? I want to spend just a few moments, and that's all I have, to talk a little bit about application. When that book is open, and God from the divine book of life said, now the book says, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. But he that believeth not shall be condemned. And then the book of my life is opened up. And he's going to say there, well, I see you were never baptized. You never repented of your sins. The divine book over here says on this side that I tell you nay, except you repent, you shall all likewise perish, Luke 13:3. It says that God wants all men everywhere to repent, Acts 17:30. But now I judge that by what you've done over here in your life, I see you never repented. Your life is being judged by the standard, the will of God. Just like Belshazzar failed because he was found in the balances, found wanting, many will be found wanting on that day because you never believed. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. That's what the book says. But when I look at the book of your life, I can see that you did everything but believe. And repent and be baptized. The book says, seek ye the kingdom of God first and his righteousness. And all these things shall be added unto you. But now let me compare that to the book of your life. And I see that you sought after everything in the world except the kingdom of God. You didn't put it first. You put it last. And you put everything else first. The book says in 1 John 2:17, love not the world, neither the things of the world. When a man loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Do not have the desire, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life, the pride of sight. Do not desire that, for the world passes away. That's what the book said. But when I read about the book of your life, I see that you love this world so much you did anything and everything to acquire more and more of it. When I examine your life is being found wanting in the scales and in the balances. And you did everything in the world but seek the kingdom of God. You loved that world. And I told you not to love the world, but you loved it anyway. I told you not to seek the things of this world first, but you did it anyway. Your life is going to be judged by the divine standard of God's word. Will you receive the same kind of judgment as an old Belshazzar? Long ago, many Tikal Upharsin, God's counted your days. You've been weighed in the balances and found wanting. And your time of judgment has come. The Bible tells us clearly that Christ is coming again. It doesn't say maybe, it says he is. The Bible is telling us that Christ is going to judge the world. It doesn't say maybe, it says he will. The Bible tells us that Christ is going to judge us based on the standard of his holy and inspired word. It doesn't say maybe, he will, by means of application. Where are you going to find yourself? Where are you going to find yourself? There's a lot of important doctrines in the pages of the Bible. A lot of important things we need to know and a lot of important things we need to understand. We can't miss this. If we miss heaven, we have missed everything. And this old world will be gone. And all the works of it will be burned up. But your soul will go on somewhere in eternity, either with God or in a devil's hell. You know, I read a fact the other day. It's amazing to me. I couldn't hardly believe it and had to look it up. I kept studying the matter to see whether it's true. And for all practical purposes, it's true from what I can determine. And the matter said, yesterday, 200,000 people died. And tomorrow, on the average, 200,000 more people are going to die throughout the world. They will die from various and sundry causes. Disease, accident, war, poverty, any number of reasons why they die. And the people who keep up with these particular numbers, I guess, try to calculate the number as best they possibly can, but I don't know that anyone really knows factually just how many people. They don't know factually how many people there are living in the world today, but they say on the average 200,000 people die every day, and they plunge themselves into eternity. And I'm concerned and fearful. Most of them, though I do not know most of them, of course, never knew the Savior, never obeyed the gospel, but are going to face a judgment, the standard of God's word. Now, my friend, this is coming from my heart straight to yours. Don't let that happen to you, having not obeyed the gospel of Christ. You repent of the gospel. You repent of your sins. Obey the gospel through obedient faith. Be baptized into Christ for the remission of sins and devote the rest of your life to the study of the Word of God, living in the kingdom, the church of Jesus Christ, and following Jesus Christ and his example every single day, so that one day the judgment will be a great day, where God is once again in full fellowship with his own. Won't you come? While together we stand and while we sing.